a former United Nations ambassador and one of the world's most recognized and admired stars. Her award-winning portrayal of Sue Ellen in the original TV series Dallas brought her international fame and critical acclaim, earning her an Emmy nomination for Best Actress and numerous international awards, and was voted Woman of the Year by the Hollywood Radio and Television Society. After 11 years as the number one show on television, Dallas has returned on TNT starring Linda Gray and is proving again to be the number one drama on cable TV. Linda appeared on stage in the original stage production of Terms of Endearment, based on the screenplay of the Oscar-winning motion picture, and also starred in the West End production of The Graduate, playing to sellout audiences, and replaced Kathleen Turner on Broadway. Linda directed many episodes of the first Dallas TV series and made her theater directing debut with Murder in the First. Her other acting stage work includes The Vagina Monologues, Agnes of God, and Love Letters, and she has numerous TV credits, including the successful series Melrose Place and Models, Inc., and has continuously appeared in feature films and television roles. Linda is celebrated for her amazing support of her charities, including Meals on Wheels and many AIDS fundraisers. We're thrilled to welcome a true Hollywood icon, our 2014 keynote speaker, and an inspiration to millions of women worldwide, Linda Gray.
Especially as a woman. So the consciousness is rising all over the world for us, and if you will look around, you will notice that women are rising like this amazing, delicious cream on the top. You see it everywhere. They're coming, we're stepping up in every area of our life. We are leading with our hearts, we are following our intuition. And we are acknowledging our birthright. When you were born with a spark of magnificence. Do you believe that? Huh? Most of us don't, but it's true. And when did we all forget that? Well, this afternoon, I'm going to focus on three words that I want you all to think about for your lives. The three words are time, love, and giving. And I want to start by telling you something that I don't usually do. I'm going to start by telling you how old I am. I mean, not 29. You love this month. And I normally don't do that, but now in the age of Google, you can find out how old anybody is. Not that it really matters. Does it matter to any of you? No. Cool. But there's a story attached to this, so I'm going to tell you, so you don't have to Google, that I'm 73 years old. And I wouldn't say this, it's not my thing, but I'm talking about time. Because last Saturday, I gave my son a 50th birthday party. So I was thrilled, but also stunned by the passage of time, that I could have a son that was older than me. It was just alarming to me. How did this happen? And I was the first one to meet him. And I am thrilled, and was thrilled from the moment of his birth to be his mother. Huge, that's our biggest thing we can do in life, is to be a mother. But what I noticed, and I want you all to think think about it is I remember his birth as if it were yesterday. And how did 50 years go by when I can remember so clearly all those years? How did that happen? So any of you that have children, children that are grown up, children that are babies, I want you to pay attention to time. Because I'm shocked at how fast it has gone on in my life. So every woman I talk to lately has the same thing in her heart that most of you have in different ways. They are exhausted. And they don't have time to do all the things they should do, want to do, could have done, supposed to do. Their days are filled and they are exhausted. They want a vacation, but they don't have time to take a vacation. They've got too much to do. So women are living on vapors that are masquerading as energy. We have to make sure that we're not doing that anymore. We have to have pure energy within us. No living on vapors. I want you to take care of yourself first. And when I tell women that, I go, take care of yourself first. They go, yeah, right, I got kids and dogs and husband and blah, blah, blah. But if you take care of yourself, that is the foundation for a life worth living. You have to do that. You have to take care of yourself. It's about taking care of others too. It's about giving yourself the nurturing and the love that you give to others. But it has to start with you. Because you have to give yourself permission to be first. And that's hard. We're not programmed for that. We're not programmed. It's like, well, what do you mean? I have this to do and that to do and this one to take care of. And I got to feed the kids and the chickens and the dogs and the husband. I got too much to do. But if you don't take care of yourself first, you can't take care of all those wonderful people that are in our lives that we love to hug. You can't. It doesn't happen. We love our children, our friends, the men in our lives, our work, our garden, cooking with our friends, learning, discovering, teaching, sharing, and caring. But an important question I have for you is, what do you care about? What defines us? What makes us who we are? How do we grow as a woman? How do we stay sane, peaceful, and magical in a chaotic world? Magic is not what we do, it's who we are. You don't need things, but you do need and value the time you spend with your friends, your family, and the men in your lives. I was raised Catholic, and I learned how to pray very, very early on. And I loved it. And I remember my friend came to me in 1973 and she said, why don't we go learn about TM? It's meditation. And I said, oh, well, I pray. I don't need to meditate. And she said, praying is asking. Meditation is listening. And I loved that. I loved hearing that. And the type A personality that I am, I said, great, I'm going to do both. I'm going to pray and I'm going to meditate. So I'd like to just share a little story with you because I think we all need to meditate. And again, we go back to the first word that I said early on, time. When are we going to find time to meditate? You want us to meditate now amongst all the other stuff that we have to do. Great. So I'm saying to you, this is a little experiment. Do any kind of meditation you want. You can go to church, you can light a candle, you can go listen to Oprah, Deepak, anybody, anything, you can pray to anything, anybody. Just have some quiet time, a special quiet time just for you. Hard to do. But as far as I know, We only have one body. And it's all about nurturing. And I go back to the time. I keep hearing women say to me that they don't have time to do that. They don't have time to meditate. They don't have time to pray. Well, I'm not asking you for an hour. I'm saying, give yourself a few things. The thing that I love to do, because I incorporate both, I take a gratitude walk. And I realized how many things in my life I have taken for granted. Taken for granted. So one day I walked, I just took a walk. I just said, I've had it, I can't, there's no time, I'm busy, blah, blah, blah. And I drove myself crazy. I took what I call my gratitude walk. And I walked around and I thought, I had not paid 5 minutes of attention to the sky, the trees, my body, my legs that work. I hadn't. And I used that time to walk, which was exercise. It was kind of multitasking. So I was walking, called it my walking meditation, and I was exercising, and I had fresh air, etc. That was my walking meditation. So if you don't want to meditate, sit there, be quiet. You can do what I do, and I do that walking meditation. And women tell me that they do not have that kind of time. Well, I'm telling you that we don't have time not to do those things, because time and life is speeding up, in case you haven't noticed. And we don't want to be left behind. And at 73, I sure as hell don't want to be left behind. So, you got a lot more years than I do, so I don't want to miss anything, and I want to spend the time, quality time, and I don't want to miss anything. I want to be the best person that I can be. How can I do that? So we all get awards, major awards, for all the negative things. We look in the mirror and we go, look at my stomach, yeah, my thighs. Look at the commute. I don't like my job. My husband's the relationship is so. And we don't like our hair, of course. And it goes on and on. I want you to stop all that. Because we are programming our subconscious in such a negative way. So if we just turn that around and say, if we meditate, go for a walk, go for your gratitude walk, instead of complaining, because those thighs and the hair and the stomach and the relationship is going to be the same, guaranteed, same thing tomorrow. If you don't take that time to say, I'm not going to talk about all that negative stuff anymore. It's boring, it's not going to change anything, and I'm not going to do it. You have to take care of your life. I can't do it, because I've been running like hell trying to take care of my life. So, we are not measured. None of us are measured by what we do. We are measured by what we give. No matter how small. A smile, a handhold, helping someone through an illness, teaching a child how to pronounce a word. I have a little story. When my grandson, the youngest grandson, was learning how to talk, I held his head and I said, Grandma. Because I had the most delicious grandma, and I wanted to be called Grandma. And so I wanted to teach him, and I said, Grandma. And he said, Manya. Well, this went on for quite a while. And it was Grandma Manya, Grandma Manya. And I thought, he's not getting this thing. So then one day, it dawned on me that wondrous child was trying to tell me something. He didn't want to call me Grandma. He wanted to call me Manya. Which all of a sudden I thought, don't listen to yourself. Listen to that child who's trying to tell you who you are. So the entire family now calls me Manya. And do I love it? You bet. I feel like an Argentinian dancer or something. I don't know. And I thought, well, I'm Manya, and I love it, and I thank my grandson for giving me that delicious new name. So so it's just going to stick. That's it. We're locked in for good. So all those little things that we do, tiny little things, holding a hand, teaching a child how to pronounce something, those are acts that enrich our souls. Little things that we can do. Now, I think you heard in the introduction, which was kind of embarrassing, it was kind of like, whoa, look at that. It helps a lot of stuff. But I did, for 10 years, I worked as a UN ambassador, a goodwill ambassador. Meaning I traveled around the world and I worked with women and children's health issues. And that is an eye-opener. And I felt so blessed to be asked to do that. Because I got to go to places that no travel agent would ever send. But that was a blessing. I went to tiny little villages in Kenya, Nicaragua, Malawi, the poorest country in the world. And I sat with the women in the dirt, on the concrete, wherever they were, and we laughed and we prepared food for them. We giggled, we did make kites so that we could fly them in with them, with the kids. We did everything, and those women were filled with joy. Filled with joy. They have nothing, zero, nothing. But they have joy in their hearts. So when I looked around, I thought, you know, this wonderful group of women I'm standing in front of today, we have the same heart as those women in Malawi and Kenya and Nicaragua who have nothing. Women are women around the world, and we are glorious. We are fabulous. And we have to know that. That's why I'm trying to say, don't bother about the negative stuff. Know how powerful, delicious, yummy you are. Because when I go around the world and I see the joy that they have, these women, I ask them, what do you want in life? And they say, we want clean water, a healthy childbirth, and an education for our children. End of story. That's all they want. Beautiful. Beautiful. And I wish that for all of us, that when you get down and negative and bah humbug and things working right, remember those women who have hearts filled with joy. They're happy, sitting on the ground, we're making dinner, soup, stuffed in a pot, having the most wonderful time, giggling and laughing, kind of like we do if we meet somebody at Starbucks, but we're the same. And I want you to remember that. It's delicious. So I want you to remember this. Just ask yourself, how can I serve? What can I do that's teeny tiny that will make me feel better, that will make your heart feel better? Just a little something. A few years ago, I was sitting in front of the computer, and I had covered up one eye, and I looked at the screen, and I thought, wow, I must have been here too long, my eyes are getting tired. And then I covered up the other eye, and I couldn't see the screen at all. And I thought, wow, this is interesting. So I went to the doctor and I said, I can't see out of my right eye. Can there be something wrong? Can you? So they came up with the line, oh, Linda, it's an age-related high blood pressure spike. I didn't want to hear age-related anything. I was like, oh, I don't have high blood pressure. What is that? He said, well, sometimes it goes up and it clamps the retina. And I said, oh, well, then how do we fix it? He said, we can't. And I said, what do you mean? I just can't see out of my right eye forever? And he said, well, they did some tests, they did some things. And then they said, no, this is as much as we can do. I said, okay. So I'm not one to listen to, we can't do anything. So I went on a search. And my friends told me about a healer in Brazil. And I said, well, what have I got to lose? I'm going to Brazil, and I'm going to meet this healer, and maybe something will happen, better than what they were telling me in Los Angeles. So I went to the healer, and they worked on my eye and sent me to my room for 24 hours. So the room was like a little monk's place. Tiny little room, white bed, white pillow, not much else. And I had brought my books and my laptop, and I brought all my stuff. So in the 24 hours, women would come and give me food, and I couldn't see anybody, couldn't do anything. Then the next day I got to go out, so I wandered around, and they said, oh, but for the next 8 days, you cannot read, you cannot write. You cannot go on the computer, you can't watch television, no iPhone, no iPad, nothing. So, I was stopped. I thought, now, what do? I can't do anything. I was like panicking. I'm like, well, where's my phone? What do you mean I have to talk on my phone? We're all addicted to that. Certainly I can have to talk to my kids. I have to tell. So what I did, they said, okay, quickly text your children, tell them where you are, what are you doing, and you won't be able to communicate for 8 days. Quit. So I walked around the room and I was mad and I was upset and I was panicked because I thought, I have become addicted to those fabulous things, technology that we all know and love. I love the internet, I love all that stuff, I love my phone, but I was like, I can't even read a book. So that's what happened. I just had to deal with it. Then I remembered that I had downloaded an MP3 on my iPad, and I listened to a wonderful, wonderful set called talking about distractions. I think it was Panache Desai, somebody, and he was talking about distractions. And I realized that all of the technology that I know and love, and I know you all do too, was a distraction keeping me away from that quiet voice. And I had to sit there and talk to myself and say, self, this is a challenge, this is a test. And then I remembered a quote by Blaise Pascal, which said, all of the problems of man come from the inability to be at ease alone in a room. And I thought, wow, I'm alone in the room and I'm not comfortable. I need to pay attention to that. And then I heard and I remembered a quote from our dear departed Maya Angelou, who said, listen to yourself. And in that quiet time, you might hear the voice of God. So it was an 8-day challenge. I didn't know what to do. I asked myself, had I lost sight of myself? Was there something in my world that I didn't want to see? So then I thought, we've all got these distractions. All of us women have these distractions around us that are keeping us away from us. And that's not okay. They're fine by themselves, but we're all panicky. We have those things on the table at dinner. And I look around the restaurant and I see a couple. They're not even talking. They're on those things. Their phones, not looking at each other. We need to look at each other. We need to understand each other. We need to talk. We can use those things too. I'm not saying give away your phone, but we need to pay attention to the time that we have allotted to those things. So think about what your distractions are. Red wine? Chocolate? Working out? Shopping? Internet? You got them. We've all got them. And maybe ask yourself, are those things keeping me away from me? So, I want to show you this funny little piece of paper. This paper I have carried around with me. It sits in a frame on my desk. This is the original paper that it was written on. Scared me. Okay. This was written and given to me in 1960. Dear Miss Gray, thank you very much for submitting your photograph to the Glamour Girl search we are conducting. I regret to say you are not the exact type of girl that we are looking for. However, we don't want you to be discouraged at this point. Perhaps if you changed your makeup a little and tried experimenting with some new hairstyling, you too might very well shape into something. Good luck. keep that there because I smile every time I see it. Because I remember when I first got it, I was devastated. I was like, oh my God, how could this happen? Well, you know, I went into the depression. Now I look at it with a huge smile. Because it was one of several rejection letters that I received. And it didn't matter at the time. And now it's a reminder that those things don't matter at all. They were somebody's opinion and they happened then. But I always had my favorite line was, watch me. Watch me, because I'm a feisty little thing and I'm gonna go do what I wanna do. So then we get into these years, and it's with great hope and anticipation that the wisdom years do kick in. Don't panic any of you youngsters out there. The wisdom years will come. And all of you wise ones out there, you know. It happens, and it's delicious. And our lives, they should improve with age, because aging doesn't have to be bad. It can be magnificent. Because all of you people my age, around this sort of group of ages here, here we are, we want to play in the sandbox. We've been there, we've done it, we've been through children, husbands, divorces, deaths of dear friends, death of family members, menopause, everything we've been through. And we survived and we're still surviving. So now we look at it like this rejection letter. It's okay. It's okay to be rejected. It's okay to do all these things. Because we're still alive on the planet, we've got a job to do. Find out what your job is. Figure it out. So, what happens when you get wise is you soften it. Soften around the edges, all the fears, guilt, resentments have been massaged and quiet. And the time is waiting for you now. The peace, calm, acceptance, and non-judgment here. You hopefully have done the work. All of you, of forgiveness. If you haven't done it, do it now. Please take all the rocks off your shoulders. Be more relaxed, compassionate, and forgiving. You know your own weaknesses and your own strengths, and you say, I'm okay with them right now. We go more, and we don't take things so seriously or so personally. So, what I remember, at the end, we asked ourselves, what did we learn from this journey of life? How things that seemed so important then are not now. They're not important anymore. So how in the end it comes down to those three words, time, love, and gift. So get ready to create a new you. Every day. But be careful because transformation can happen instantly. It will creep up on you, and I hope it does. Larry Hagman, my dear friend Larry Hagman, toward the end of his life represented a solar company. He wore a button on his label that is now on my bulletin board that said, shine, baby, shine. And I changed that a little bit in my own way. And this is what I want to leave you with today. Take the time to love and to give. And shine, all you goddesses out there. Shine. Thank you.
Ladies, if you've got a question for Linda, please come up here. I've got a microphone. I want her to hear your question. This is Mary Linda.
Hi, Mary.
Long time fan of Dallas. My question was the rest of your story about your eye in the 8 days. What happened with your eye?
Yeah, you have a question.
Oh, can you hear the question? She's asking about my eye after the 8 days, what happened? There's a little healing. I can see a little bit. What happens is I can't see. Like if I look at somebody, I can't see their face. I can see their hair, everything. Can't see that. So that's still a little disturbing. But it's getting better. Thank you, Mary.
This is Chandra.
Hi, Chandra.
Hi, Linda.
Hi, Mary.
Hi, how have you managed to stay so beautiful all these years?
It's so sweet. I don't know. I love the question. I think we're all beautiful. I swear to you. It's not something I'm just saying. I don't know. I think it's energy. I don't know. I have a lot of energy. And you know, I don't know. I do all the things they say, you know, do this. I do. Drink a lot of water. That's helpful. No, because it hydrates your skin. Okay. Hi.
This is Becca Ramos.
Linda, I've got one question for you from one goddess to another. Can I get a picture with you?
Of course. Absolutely.
We can do that afterwards.
We'll do those afterwards. Yes, thank you. It's a pleasure.
That's right. Yeah.
Linda, this is Jen.
Okay. Hello.
Hi.
I've been trying to start keeping this now. And I was at Southport when we were there for the reunion.
Oh.
And I actually got you to sign a card for my mom's birthday. And I haven't seen my mom since then, but I sent her the card and she appreciated it.
Oh, great.
And I promised my mom would do it again.
I'll do it again.
Would you mind?
Not at all.
Because we're both just huge fans and I told her I was going to see her today. And I said I'm going to take a card so I can get it again for her.
Thank you. My pleasure.
Hi, this is Cindy.
Hi, Cindy.
Hi, Linda. I've been a fan of yours for many, many years, and I'm so glad you did the Dallas series.
Yeah.
First of all, I'd like to know if I could come spend the weekend with you. Just kidding.
Take a gratitude walk.
No, seriously, I want to thank you for supporting Gays. I really want to thank you for that. And secondly, I want to know what your first impression of J.R. Ewing was.
Oh, dear. That's a great question. my first impression was I thought, who is... Well, I said, actually, what I said to myself was, who the hell is that? He walked into a room when we were doing our first meeting as a cast. And he walked in with a Stetson cowboy boots, a fringe jacket, a big belt buckle thing, and a carved saddlebags that were filled with ice and two bottles of champagne. two bottles of champagne. He just looked at me and said, hello, darling. And I thought, oh, this is going to be a bumpy ride. And it was.
I wish I could get an autograph on that.
Yeah. This is Tammy.
Hi, Tammy. I'm a biggest fan of Dallas also. And I was wondering how you and Patrick Duffy was when you got the new series. How did that came about in Larry Hammond, how you got the new series with the younger sons?
Okay. A quick story. Patrick, Larry and I were friends for 37 years. I mean, really good friends. Soul friends. And so 2 years ago, 2 years on, it's got to be 5 years ago, we got a call saying, would you be interested in doing Dallas again? Wow. We all called each other, would you be thrilled? I got to stop being Italian. So we said, sure, we'd be interested. 2 years went by, we never heard a word. So then they sent us an actual script and said, would you be interested? And we said, yes, if there's a script attached, yes. So they had just invited the three of us and we called each other and we were so excited, like five-year-olds, saying, yay, we get to play in this little box. So we were back again and then we lost Larry. But Mr. Hagman is still with us. We're feeling on the set. So he's still there, making trouble.
Next question, Linda, is from Miss Pat.
Miss Pat. Hi, Miss Pat. Hi.
First of all, you're gorgeous. I'm standing here close to the past for 45 easy. Don't tell anybody else anything.
Yeah, don't tell anybody.
Okay. No. I wanted to know if I could get an autograph.
Of course.
Good.
My pleasure.
And again, the way that you look going through your age, you really
thank you. Very good. I feel great. So you don't have to do the age. Don't do the, none of you. Don't do the age. Pick a number and stay there.
Okay. Back to your Jabal.
Hey, it's great to have you back in Dallas again. You look fantastic.
Thanks.
I was wondering, could you do a line from Sue Ellen or her facial expression after she takes a drink?
I realized I didn't have to stand back there. It's exciting. Let me see, can I do, oh boy. Those are tricky ones. I don't know what I'll think about it.
After a drink.
After the drink?
I love that.
She's been drinking a lot.
Am I in your way?
I don't know about her. Yeah. But you know, I mean, if you watch the new series, you know that she's like on the ground and there's fire around her. Scared me. Yeah. It's because of the drink. I was so, the day we were, days we were filming all that drinking stuff. I mean, I was just drinking. It was tea, diluted tea, room temperature tea, pouring. Drinking all day long. It's enough. So I'll try. Let me figure out what I can do. Okay.
This is Debbie.
Hi, you look so beautiful. I'm so excited to see you. I know you're coming back in August, the show. I hope you make it through the fire.
Me too. I pray I do.
Do they have other seasons planned beyond the short season in August?
Well, I want to be able to stand here and say, yes, we're coming back. They don't tell us anything. Actors are the last to know anything, unfortunately. So they figure it all out, all the politics stuff and the money stuff. I don't know, those people that do that. We don't do that. It would be a mess if we did. So we're fingers crossed that we'll do season 4. So
I'm hoping. We hope you're here forever. Thanks.
Thank you very much.
And this is Ashley.
Hi, Ashley.
Hi, Miss Gray. I just want to tell you, I really admire that all your artistic endeavors. But I really respect and appreciate what you've done humanitarian-wise. And I just wanted to say from my heart, I just wanted to hug you for that. And I really, and you're right, we are all part of a sisterhood of women. And I'm really grateful for what you said and all your words were very inspiring. And I was wondering, have you ever considered writing a book of inspirational, you know, meditational verse or whatever to guide women through their life? No, and so forth.
Well, yes. No, I'm very excited, and I talk about intuition. You have great intuition because, yes, I just signed to do a book. I'm just so excited, and now I'm terrified. What am I going to write? Anyway, yes. A book will be coming out, so I don't know when, but I haven't started written one word yet, but I was thrilled to ask.
I'm actually an inspiring novelist, so I'm right there with you. We could be in there together.
We could do this together.
Wow, thank you so
lovely.
Much. Thank you for being here.
Thank you. Lovely to meet you.
I wanted to see these very young fans that have come to see you. Come on up, guys.
Hi.
How are you? What's your name?
Carly. Amaya.
Are you brothers and sisters? No?
These two are brothers and sisters.
Right, and then who are you in the back? You're an imposter. Who are you? Your cousin. Good.
Do you have something for Linda? Do you want to give it to her? Okay, come on up.
Can you get up here? Can you jump? No. Can I jump? Oh, wow! Hi! Look at you! Look at this hair! Turn around! This is the coolest hair! Whoa! Did your mommy do that? Okay, you can have my autograph. What is your name? Carmen, can you spell it? C. C. A. R.
E.
Excellent. Okay.
One second. Stick around for a few more minutes after.
I need something to write on a grandma. She don't have any pictures.
How old?
Six.
Oh, six. Well, you hear it. Well, you hear it.
You can come by yourself.
You came with your mom.
Okay. Do Charlie and Amaya after? How's this?
Sure.
No.
Linda, any final thoughts for the ladies?
Just go be as fabulous as you are. I mean it. I'm going to come back next year. There's a test. So you can do all your stuff, right? She got stuff to do. Homework. Lovely to be here with you. Thank you for coming.
Linda Kay, ladies.